Yaskawa.
You're watching the PLCopen Basics video tutorial series. This video shows how to stop motion and how to diagnose and clear alarms. Hi, I'm Matt Pelletier. We'll use three fundamental PLCopen instructions in this section. Those are MC stop, MC reset, and MC read access error. We'll also see how these tie in specifically to the Yaskawa servo hardware. So here's the program map as we're progressing, and it's time to add the program POU called stop into the slow task of our project. You can work along with me here. We'll just right click, insert a program called stop. We got ladder diagram language. We said we'd run it in the slow task. So right down here, insert program instance, stop and stop. And let's open that stop program. And like we've done before with the other program POUs, we'll use the existing HMI toggle Boolean interface to stop both the screw and the rotary motor at the same time. MC stop is pretty straightforward, not really any fancy features. There's the execute input and the decel rate. And we'll just stop both axes at the same time. So please go ahead and build this and test it out. And then I'll do the same and demonstrate a few points. Okay, let's build a couple MC stops. MC stop for the screw. And we'll use G underscore stop screw for that one. And we have somewhat of an arbitrary long decel time. We'll call it stop decel. It's just a local var. And we'll give it a value of 1 million. That's 1 with 6 zeros, 0.0, because it's an L real. You can put these underscores in there to hold the place value. Okay. Now the same thing for the rotary axis. Rotary, G stop rotary, these already exist from the HMI POU. We'll use that same stop decel. And you know, as long as we're at it here, let's add one for the virtual. MC stop for the virtual axis. We got G stop virtual. And we'll use the same stop decel on here also. So that along with the HMI, looks like I had a G stop virtual but don't have it in the code. That's not too hard. You can right click if it's not in there. I may end up adding it in there. Add a parallel contact here with this or this one parallel. And we'll put in G underscore stop virtual. Stop them all with one input. All right, let's download those changes. Okay, now if we want to have something to stop, we need to start it first. So I'll start the motion that we had before. And now let's see if we can cancel it during one of the moves. So there, I stopped it right during the move, and you notice that it didn't finish the move like it did before when we just turned off the start input. Additionally, notice that if you try to restart the motion, it cannot. Start off, start on, and in fact, if you look at the positioning POU, you'll see that it has an error. It can't start, and we know why it can't start. It can't start because the stop block is on, and if you look at the help, and scroll down to the errors, you'll see that 4370 says the move could not be started because motion's prohibited. Why could this be? Could not be enabled. Maybe the stop execute is held high because no other block can override the stopping state. And that's exactly what we're seeing happen here, is the stop block is on for that axis, and so we can't start. So this is an important distinction because we had said earlier that PLCopen activates at the rising edge. And while that is true, stop is a special case where if it's executing, no other motion can be initiated on that axis. Second part of this video is to both read and reset alarms that you might have. And so let's make another program POU called reset. Also in the slow task, we'll insert a new program called reset. And add it to the fast task. Insert a program instance, reset. Reset, reset. And let's open that POU. And the HMI POU has coils to reset the screw, the rotary, and the controller. So there's the two real axes and the controller. PLCopen covers reading and resetting the axes. And those are the MC reset, MC read axis error. Again, very simple blocks. You just give it the axis and tell it whether it should execute the reset or whether it should enable the reading of the error. We'll typically set that to true if you just want that to constantly read the error. And these will read axis-related errors like over torque, over speed. But for controller-related errors, such as a controller battery that's dead or a network communication failure, that's going to be here through the read alarm and clear alarm directly on the controller. And those are Y underscore blocks, so they're not part of PLCopen. But nonetheless, it's a good time to introduce those. So like before, why don't you go ahead and enter this code in, and then we will work with it and produce some alarms and clear them. So I've got an MC reset here for the screw axis, and we'll tell that one here to reset with G, reset to go down here to reset screw. Put another one for the rotary, MC reset, rotary, and that one's got a variable called G reset down to rotary. The counterparts to those are MC read axis error for the screw axis, and you could leave these enabled. I could also see the wisdom in connecting this error output to enable only if you do have an error. And read axis error also for the rotary. And then in case there's any problems with the controller, we have Y underscore clear alarms. That one can be executed with G reset controller. And its counterpart is Y underscore read alarm. And we'll leave that one as true. And let's download changes for this one. So now the question becomes, how can we test this? And one way to test this is to set both your speed and distance to an amount that's too high. And on these motors, 40,000 will be sufficient. But you do have to set both speed and distance, and I recommend you do it in that order. So open up the positioning POU, and let's set this velocity to 40,000. And the distance also to 40,000. And then we'll use the HMI here. We'll remove the stop and start it again. And you'll see that it kind of moved, but there's this alarm light on. You can kind of tell it's red. There's a controller alarm. Definitely in the web page, if you wanted to look at the alarm status, you could see that there is an alarm, A510. That's over speed. If you still don't believe me, you could look at the servo itself. It's flashing A.510. So we've got an overspeed A510. And we can confirm that here in the reset POU. But curiously, it says that the error ID is 1296. And that's because it's displaying a hexadecimal error code in decimal. But we can force this to display in hexadecimal. Just open any of these variables, like maybe G reset screw. And there's this value display, which can be forced to hexadecimal. This is a software setting. And now we see in hexadecimal 16 pound 510 with the error class 3303. And since I did have the web page up, you'll see that those alarm codes are listed, and there's even a tooltip here, 3303. So this is all vendor specific. These codes themselves are up to Yaskawa. And there's two parts to the code. There's the access error and the error class. So one thing that I like to do sometimes is not go to everything hexadecimal, leave it in standard, and then you can make a little modification to this program. We can convert these access error ID and error class using the type convert functions. And if you hover on it, it says here it's a uint and a uint. So we can go here, type u for uint, uint to word, because really the way that Yaskawa alarms are defined are as words. So we'll pull out a uint to word. Okay, I've got the en, eno. I'm going to go to the objects menu and turn that off. I can update that function and give a little room here. Hit control and spawn a copy. And you could call this alarm screw. And this one, error class screw. Let's download changes. All right, so we still have this alarm. And now in debug mode, we'll see it because the word data type defaults to hex. But what we really do need to do here is to reset it. So let's prove that that works by going to the reset screw. We just reset them all at once. And did that reset anything? It sure did. That alarm is gone. We can even refresh the web page. And the alarm status shows it's gone. Of course, the alarm history shows that it did happen. And that's your basic functionality for reset and reading access errors. And now a little bit about Yaskawa going beyond PLCopen. PLCopen uses the term error. And Yaskawa tends to use the word instead alarm and warning. And so just to clarify what those terms mean, alarm means that the servo will stop because motion cannot continue and the servo will be disabled. And you'll have an alarm code starting with A. Here's a few examples: over voltage, over speed, overload, encoder overheat. There's a lot of different alarms, and you can look at the alarm displays in chapter 9 of the current Sigma 5 servo user manual. But we have a lower level warning code system, which tells you that there's a future alarm pending if you continue the current conditions. But at this time, the servo remains enabled, although you will get a code starting with A.9 and two more digits. And a few examples here are position error overflow warning, or overload warning, or command warning, or an under voltage warning. So we're warning you that an alarm will soon happen so that you hopefully could change the operating conditions from the controller side and avoid the shutdown for that access when the alarm happens. And one final housekeeping order of business is the task order. If you look at our slow task, we've added quite a few of these program POUs into the slow task, and it's time to really think critically and logically about the order that these POUs are in there. And if you look at the order we have, it's really not the most ideal, because while the commands starts with the HMI, we have that at the bottom. So it's not even looking for the inputs until the very end of the scan. So really when I turn on one of the inputs in HMI I, It doesn't take effect until the next scan, so there could be a slight delay. So it's time that we do some reordering of it here. Be sure you're out of debug mode. Also, please be sure that you close this resource. If any of you have the resource open, good practice is to keep closing that thing. And we'll put the HMI I up at the top. And then maybe the next most important thing is, do we need to stop? And then perhaps the next most important thing is, do we need to enable? And if there's any problem, maybe then reset. So these are still cyclic. They're happening every slow task cycle. But it makes a little more sense to put them in an order like this than it does to have the HMI inputs at the bottom. So this is a change to the code. You do need to download changes, remake it, and re-download it. And with this simple code, you probably won't see any performance changes. But it brings up a few important points, like that you can easily drag and drop these task order. And now we have a more logical sequence within this code where the human touches the physical input. The inputs are read by the assigned task. And I know we don't have physical I/O. We're just clicking on the global variables. So with our setup, we're starting right about here. But if you'd add the real inputs, you'd have to consider the input modules also. And then finally writing the globals to actually do the motion. So it should go in the correct order. And it's just a good practice to think about that, not just be blind to the order of the POUs in your tasks. So let's just wrap it up here and save a copy of this as a zip. This is number 7, stop and alarm. Zip it. And that'll be it for this video.